My name is Ali Kokmen. I am by day a merchandising manager for Barnes & Noble, where I get to look after the presentation of books on our website and our award-winning platform of e-books, readers, on the Nook platform. So if you could do one thing for me today, if you buy just one book today, if you buy just one e-book, please make it a Nook book, because every time you don't buy a Nook book, your favorite characters die.
Wow.
But, you know, none of that matters, right? None of that matters as a bookseller. It doesn't matter how much I want to get you the perfect book to read if there wasn't somebody writing those fantastic books. And that's why we're incredibly lucky today to have five authors with us who are at the absolute best of what they do, to talk to you a little bit about the notions of diversity and class in fiction and fantasy. So I'd like to introduce our panel of authors, if I may. Laurent Linn. Laurent's love of puppets has led him to Jim Henson's Muppet Workshop, where he created characters for productions including Muppet Christmas Carol and Muppet Treasure Island. I will refrain from doing the pirate song.
Please don't.
Eventually becoming the creative director for Sesame Street Muppets and Emmy Award winning at that. He's currently an art director and designer for children's and teen books, where his love of transformative stories and superheroes led him to write and illustrate Draw the Line, his first novel. Laurent Linn. And we have, well, having come to New York via Ohio and Kentucky both, Lara Elena Donnelly can now be found Lindy hopping and absinthe sipping at all of Manhattan's extravagant jazz age parties, as well as writing poetry and speculative fiction that's appeared in such venues as Strange Horizons and Nightmare and Escape Pod. But what she's really excited to be here for is her very first novel, Amberlough, coming to you February 7th, 2017.
I believe you can pre-order it. You can get a Nook copy.
And is a convert to the sartorial splendor that is the bow tie. Jennifer Jenkins, in the middle, has degrees in history and secondary education and a general obsession with ancient warfare and battle strategy.
All of totally which, look that, right? I totally look that.
All of which come to bear not only in her novels, but also in her work as the co-founder of the Teen Author Bootcamp, a writer's conference specialized for aspiring teen authors. Among her support system is Jennifer's three children, who are experts at naming her characters, a loving, supportive husband, a dog with a little man syndrome, and I'm told three chickens who secretly terrify her. And we have Marie Lu. Marie graduated from the University of Southern California and jumped into the video game industry as an artist, but now she's a full-time writer, the author of the number one New York Times best-selling series, The Young Elites. First one, Young Elites, then Rose Society, then wrapping up in The Midnight Star, coming to bookstores everywhere, one imminently, Tuesday. And at the end, we have Daniel Jose Older, a Brooklyn-based writer, editor, former paramedic, current composer, and author of the Bone Street Rumba novels, Half Resurrection Blues and Midnight Taxi Tango. He also facilitates workshops on storytelling, music, anti-oppression organizing at public schools and religious houses and universities. Daniel Jose Older. Ladies and gentlemen, your panel. Well, we're here to talk about diversity and class in fantasy. And I thought one of the best ways to start that off is to talk to our authors themselves about how these themes have resonated in the works that we're talking about. So, Laurent, would you care to kick it off for us?
Sure. So my novel is called Draw the Line, and pardon me, allergies are strong. The force is strong with allergies right now in New York. And it's basically, I wanted to explore the concept of how to fight brutality and fight for justice with art. And so it's about a boy, Adrian Piper, he's 16. He's obsessed with Renaissance art, superheroes, he's a sci-fi fantasy geek, and he's gay. So he creates a gay Renaissance superhero, like you do. I'm sure you all have. Comic, his name is Graphite, and there's a fantasy world he creates through this comic. And so it's an illustrated novel. There are 90 pages of comic art that I did in the book, so you really see what he's doing. And so he creates this world of graphite that, I know you can't see, but anyway, there's his whole...
Oh, I'll be Nevada for you.
Why, thank you. So it's really, he witnesses a really horrific hate crime, and he has to figure out what to do. Is he a bystander, or does he actually take action and do something about it? And so he, with his art, he fights for justice. And he's living, because superheroes fascinate me, the whole concept of how we project ourselves onto superheroes and to the power. But then when does it become us? When do we figure out our real life superpowers, how we can change the world? We're not all activists. I'm not running for office, God forbid. But it's art and writing.
Yeah, surely.
Yeah. so it's through, and I want a reader to come away with it thinking, what is my real life superpower? What can I do that can change the world? So that's what Draw the Line is all about.
I just want to get to the good now, some really fantastic stuff towards the end.
It goes there. It really goes there.
All right, so my debut novel, Amberlough, which is coming out very soon, terrifyingly soon.
February 7th,
currently available for pre-order. Maybe if you buy it in Nook, no one will die.
Why take the risk?
Yeah. It is a vintage glam spy novel that's sort of like a cross between, when we pitched it as John le Carré meets Cabaret. So it's got the intrigue and the violence and the danger of Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy, and then all of the glamorous queerness of 1930s Berlin-style nightclub scenes. So the three main characters are a stripper at the Cabaret, a smuggler who also works as the Cabaret MC, who is currently being investigated by a spy and also having an affair with the same spy who's investigating him. So they're all a bit tangled up in the midst of a nascent fascist revolution. And every time I pitch this novel to people, they say, oh, a nascent fascist revolution, how timely. So it is it's a political thriller, and it's fantasy. There's no magic, but it's in an invented world. That draws a lot on Jazz Age culture and sort of that pre-World War II, like, dizzy, desperate need to have fun before the whole world falls apart as the world is falling apart beneath you. So that is what it is, and I'm very excited for it to come out. I'm very excited for hopefully the world not to fall apart and everyone to read this book and go, wow, so glad that didn't happen to us. So yeah, that is Amberlough.
Sounds awesome. I'm a young adult fantasy author of the Nameless series. Nameless, Clanless just came out Tuesday, so go and grab it. The story of Nameless takes place in a very volatile tribal clan society. And it's rife with race differences, equality issues, lots of prejudice, lots of hatred. And, you know, I think as a fantasy author, it's not my job to try and preach to my readers or try and educate them in any way. I try to entertain, that's the purpose, but adding diversity in my books, I feel lends authenticity to the story and to the characters and gives us a point of reference as readers. But really, it's a story of a girl named Zoe who infiltrates an enemy clan as a spy with a huge vendetta and ends up having to trust the enemy and ends up falling in love with an enemy soldier and all of the complications that come with that. So it's about kind of discovering the worth of an individual, not based on their race or social standing, but about the content of their character and their heart and their actions, and judging them that way. So that's Nameless. And yeah, thanks for having me.
My current series is The Young Elites, and the last book in the trilogy, The Midnight Star, is coming out on Tuesday. This is a series that is set in an alternate fantasy version of Renaissance era Italy. And it tells a story of what happens when the equivalent of the Black Death sweeps through this world, and some of the young people who survive come out of it marked and scarred, and occasionally with strange powers. And it's set in this time and place, much like our real time, where if people don't understand what's happening, they tend to fear it and want to burn it at the stake. So that's what happens to these young people, and they band together and have to protect themselves. And the story centers around this young girl named Adelina, who is essentially the teen girl version of Darth Vader. The entire series is chronicling her downfall into darkness, why she becomes a villain, why she chooses to fall and to become wicked and strike back against everyone who has harmed her in life, and whether or not you can find redemption after doing horrible things to other people, even if she thinks that it's in the name of justice. So. It's a series that explores the concept of what is right and what is wrong, what is good and what is evil, and how a lot of us, everyone thinks that they're the hero of their own story, and she does as well, except for everyone around her who's like, oh my God, what's wrong with you? And it kind of chronicles how her thought process goes. It is written in first person, which was very unsettling for me to try to wrap my head around the way that she thinks.
So, was it therapeutic, or was it causing the need for therapy to write this character in the first?
I probably the second. I actually ended my next book coming out next year was actually my detox book. So that one is like full of rainbows and colors and happy thoughts.
I really want to read all these books right now. Like I'm not supposed to talk about my books right now, but those all sound amazing. I'm Daniel Jose Older. This is Midnight Taxi Tango, and this is Shadow Shaper. I need a table. This is Shadow Shaper. The sequel comes out September next year, and the last book in the Bone Street Roomba series, I need a table, comes out, or I'll just become a juggler, comes out in January. That's a good idea. Yeah, so
these chairs may look glamorous, but they're actually really difficult to deal with.
I've got odds on her falling first.
But I write
Please,
about...
no wagering.
I write about characters in Brooklyn dealing with all kinds of supernatural shit, and I swear a lot. And, you know, because Brooklyn is still mostly black and brown folks, against the wishes of clearly the real estate industry and a lot of other folks, that's what I write about, and that's who I write about. And because when I was a kid trying to find myself in science fiction and fantasy, I couldn't as a Latino, that's also what I write about. And because we weren't there, or we were there, but we were bad guys, or we were jokes, you know? So to me, like, we're talking about diversity, what we're really talking about is telling the truth. And it's a very basic truth that you see when you walk down the street, you know, we exist, we're there. But it seems like the publishing industry, which is 80% white, is just coming around to realize, like, oh, there you guys are. Where have you been all this time? And we're here, like, where the fuck have you been? You know what I mean? Which I think is a really good question that we need to be asking, because if it wasn't for the folks that really stood up and have been standing up, largely women of color, taking a stand online and other places, you know, we wouldn't even be having this panel, because the publishing industry was very happy to keep going with this narrative of whiteness saving the world over and over, which is really troubling, because, you know, where are we, where are our kids gonna look when they need to find protagonists that look like them? So that's a lot of why I write, and to tell a great story, and to talk about ghosts and magic and creatures and fighting off evil anthropologists from Colombia, like we've all had to do at one time or another. And those are my books. So I'm very happy to be here with you guys.
Fantastic. Well, you touched on it a bit, so it's a nice segue. But so much of fantasy writing, in order to be successful, has to invest a whole lot into building the world. And I'm curious for our panel, is your approach to world building any different, knowing that you're simultaneously wanting to draw in other representations that have been underserved in the past, or actually touch on different cultures and themes or historical epics that epochs. You write the epics, we'll reference the epochs. But does this desire for representation change your approach to world building?
Yes.
Would you care to elaborate?
I found while I was writing this book that I would, every time I brought in a character, I kind of had a default, not necessarily like a single default character, but like I had to bring in a character who was a secretary and I defaulted to a woman. And then had like got maybe a chapter into writing this character and was like, why did I automatically make the secretary a woman? Is there a reason? And the secretary's boss was a man, and they were both white. And I was like, well, okay, why did I do that? Is there any reason that they are both white and that they are sort of like fulfilling the traditional gender roles of these two positions? And so I ended up changing them. And they were also having an affair, right? So it was like, of course, the boss is having an affair with his secretary. And I was like, wait, what if I made the boss a woman, a black woman, an immigrant, and her secretary is a man who's older than her, and they're still having an affair, and she's like in this position of power. And that was just one example of questioning the unconscious biases that you bring as a writer when you're building your world.
But do you see what she did right there? That's so much more interesting than her first
scenario.
I hope
so. yeah. So when you no, go ahead. We're supposed to encourage polite and interesting crosstalk on this panel.
Yes.
But when you
somebody read the email.
The email also mentioned that Ali would be wearing a bow tie, and that we would all be able to recognize him by his bow tie. So I thought that I would complicate that, which is. Right. Which, to bring it back to the subject, when you question your unconscious biases as an author building a world, you complicate that world, you make it more interesting, you make it more complex, you make it different from the world that we already live in. And it's fantasy. You want it to be different. You want it to be something that is unlike anything people have encountered in their real lives. Or at least you want them to read it and go, wow, that's so original, that's so like meaty and interesting.
I think one of the joys of writing fantasy is that you get to play out those experiments. And I know that for Nameless, I studied history, right? And I am obsessed with warfare. And did anybody ever see the, now that I'm gonna try and reference it, I can't remember the name, The Greatest Warrior, what is that show? Like, it's pretty much where they would... No, it was pretty much where they would match, like...
Oh, I remember that.
A Spartan warrior up against, like, a samurai.
Versus a Viking or something.
It's like a historical battle. Or
okay, that was that was the foundation for this book. Not really, awesome. But kind of. As a historian, I'm like, wow, you know what, taking that, and then instead of just looking at individuals, looking at cultures on a broader level, and going, wow, what would ancient Sparta look like next to Maori Islander, right? Mm. Right? And then having that experiment and really giving, I think that when I build worlds, I want to see different cultures because it breathes life into the story. It feels real, even though I'm writing fantasy, it makes it feel more authentic and it makes it feel more real. I don't know. Sorry, that was random.
Don't apologize.
I think it's go ahead, Mary.
No,
you go ahead. You. I'm wearing a suit. I'm a gentleman today.
Very polite. We're very polite.
I love that all of what we're saying is we're doing this in the pursuit of a good story. You know, this is not, we're not shoehorning in diversity just for the sake of diversity. It's because we're trying to create real worlds in a rich story, and sometimes that's what makes sense. You know, like when I was making The World for the Young Elites, it's very, very heavily based on real historical Italy and like that Mediterranean area, Constantinople, you know, it was like the hub of trade. So it doesn't make sense for that city to be not diverse. Like it would be full of people from all around the world trading with each other, and I need to reflect that in the story, otherwise it rings false, and even if readers can't put their finger on it, they'll know something is off about this world. So I do it because it makes sense. It's logical. There's no other way of doing it. And it makes for a better story, so.
Thank you for saying that, because, you know, God forbid somebody point out that, like, something like Game of Thrones doesn't have that many people of color, and then you get thousands of eggs in your mentions telling you that that's not historically accurate. A show with dragons, you know what I mean?
Yes, there's three dragons.
First of all, that's not historically accurate. Second of all, it's not a historical show, it's a fantasy. Third of all, we were there. People of color were there throughout history, throughout European history. There have been people of color in all of those European cities doing amazing things, and that's on the record. There's a really great Tumblr called Medieval POC that you should all check out. But it's not a debate, you know, it's just a fact. And they act like, you know, to put any kind of non-white element or non-straight element is somehow enforced, or like it's us being like, oh yeah, we're just gonna be there for quote-unquote PC or something, when the truth is, it takes a lot of effort to put that much blinders on to pretend that it's all white all the time. That's a lie that folks are living and that literature has been perpetuating. So I think that's messed up, and I'm really glad you said that. And for me, I always teach my students that I love the question, because I think world building is such a rich place to get into these ideas of who we are and, you know, what our culture is. And like, for me, world building is really equivalent to harmony, right? So the way we stack notes on top of each other for a chord, and then story is like melody, right? So these are the events of what's taking place, and around it there's this huge teeming world with power dynamics and different folks bumping up against each other and history. And if you're really paying attention, and if you're really invested in world building, you know, that will just be there. That rich history will all come through. I always think about how in Brooklyn, you know, you can walk down a street named after Malcolm X and turn a corner and be on a street named after someone that owned human beings, you know? And then there'll be on the wall a mural of someone who was killed who will never have an obituary written for them. And so that mural is the only way that anybody can remember that that was a human that was loved and cared for. So all these levels and layers of history are just right there on the surface. And I particularly see it in Brooklyn because that's where I live and that's what I love. And I think, like, we just make our book so much deeper when we look at that history full in the face and let it into the fantasies that we're writing.
And it also, like, talking about world, the world building, the world we live in is our world. And my favorite college professor for art history, he was teaching and someone said, is this art history? His name was Dr. Bakke. And they said, is this art history or Dr. Bakke's art history? And he said, there's no such thing as art history. Of course it's Dr. And it's true, like, there's no such thing as history. We've been in this world, it's all interpreted. And so who has written history? Who are we reading? You know, if we're reading history, we're seeing the paintings, sculpture of history. It's through that person's view. And we live in this world. So even if you're writing about a different world, you're writing about history, the readers, we're in this world. And so we have a responsibility, I think, especially writing young adult novels, to represent the world we're in. And so one thing that's been ingrained in me, because I was with Muppets for many, many years, and I was raised on Sesame Street, as I think most of us were. And then I literally went to work on Sesame Street every day. And each character, the diversity was just a given. I mean, that was just a given. And so when we're writing, each character how many people here are writers? Yay.
Yeah.
How many illustrators? Yay. Come on, be proud. But every character, everything in a book has to have a purpose. Every character has to have a purpose. And so for Draw the Line, when I was writing Draw the Line, it takes place in a contemporary high school, and then also has this alternate fantasy world. And so if someone comes from a certain ethnicity or religion or gender identity, that has to have a purpose with that character. And it can't be arbitrary, like you were saying. We can't just say, oh, I'll make this character African-American. I have one of my main character's best friends is an African-American girl, and her experience of prejudice is different from the main character's experience because he's a white boy, but he's gay. So how does that play into the relationship? How does that play into the story? It has to be thoughtfully written that way, because I think everybody can see if there's just tokenism put into a book. And so that has to be grounded in the world.
Yeah, I hate, and everybody can see it when it's the token African-American in the story, or, oh, let's show that we're progressive, so we'll put a homosexual boy in here. And it's just like, really? Really?
make them a superhero for crying out loud. You know, make something happen with that. I hate that because it's just so calculated, and I don't like it. Sorry.
I think is the genre of fantasy and the trappings that come with the genre at all, no matter what it is, but are those is fantasy constricting or is it empowering for some of these kinds of stories that we want to tell?
Empowering.
Super empowering.
Absolutely empowering.
Well, it's been both, I think, and that's sort of the thing we're up against is that, like, I think it sounds like everyone here really uses it in an empowering way. But the past hasn't always been that way. You know, fantasy has been used as a bludgeon on us for a long time to explain why things like imperialism were cool. So it's like, it's so empowering right now to see folks of color and queer folks and trans folks and doing, you know, telling our own stories. And that's amazing. And that, in a sense, is a counter-narrative to the long, long history of fantasy being about white supremacy and cis-heteropatriarchy.
I think it's... whether it's empowering or not, it's sort of the point of fantasy is that you can do anything, which opens up this huge realm of possibilities for, like we were talking about earlier, for exploring things that aren't necessarily, that aren't common or haven't been thought of, or different ways to approach problems that do exist. Also to talk about, So in Amberlough, right, the society pre-fascist revolution is very socially liberal. There's a lot of acceptance of queer characters. There's gender equality, but it still has like some problems with racism. It still has white collar crime. There's huge problems with poverty and corruption, and it's a way of talking about how problems exist on multiple axes of oppression, as opposed to just, oh, there's a gay boy in this book and he's oppressed he's gay, right? But like, take away the oppression because he's gay, like, does he have other problems that he's dealing with? Or like, just that in fantasy we can explore the way that oppression intersects in ways that maybe it would be harder to explore
in ways that can be relatable to a lot of different people, all at the same time. Anyway,
sorry. Also, if you look at Star Trek, I use references that I think most people know. Star Trek was, if you haven't heard of Star Trek, you're in the wrong place.
What are you doing at Comic-Con?
Comic-Con. What they were doing in the the original series, as well as Next Generation and others, what they were doing that you could not do in a realistic drama on TV, because they were exploring interracial relationships, they're exploring gender identity, they're exploring all of these things that, because it was fantasy, it had a grounding in reality, which it always has to have a grounding in reality, but it was fantasy, so you could step back and it's a purple, well, it's like Muppets, it's a purple person and a green person, so it's not as threatening. It can reach more people who won't push it away because it's fantasy, and I think that's the power. That's one of the powers of fantasy.
I also think Octavia Butler is a really great example of this, because she was able to think and talk and write these stories about power in a way that we haven't really seen, like, ever in fiction and in science fiction. But she used science fiction and fantasy and ideas like time travel and magic and shape-shifting to really talk about the relationships between two individuals and how they fit into this much larger society and how complicated that is by all these power dynamics that y'all have been talking about. And that's really who I looked to when I was trying to find, you know, some kind of light in this tunnel of the complexity that is fantasy fiction, was to, you know, have someone who had a language of power that wasn't, you know, Foucault, that was this language that you had to read 15 times to understand, or I did. But, you know, and still was telling these great stories and talking about war and fighting and, you know, all this, and love and everything else, but also having this conversation about these dynamics between people, you know, which kills us and which lifts us up at the same time.
The other piece we talked a little bit about is character, right? So in the worlds that we're building, you still also have to have characters with agency and power and who are at least interesting. And Marie, certainly your young elite protagonist is protagonist probably seems the wrong word, actually, but how did you approach creating that character who's so unique and giving her all the agency and power that she that story deserves?
It was very strange tackling Adelina, just because my first series, Legend, starred two young people who are very clearly good people. It was set in a dark dystopian world, but you know, they thought the right things, they came from good families, they were raised right. And Adelina is coming from a place of, she's been through this very dark childhood, and she has very, very different thoughts from me. But as I was writing her, what was interesting and kind of disturbing for me was I could see bits and pieces of myself popping up in Adelina as I was writing her. You know, when she's flipping out at somebody, I think back. You know, I live in LA, so you know, I think about all the times that I've been stuck in traffic, and how when someone cuts me off in traffic, yes, all the freeways. I have many stories, and in that moment, I'm just like, I just want to crush your car right now with a giant Godzilla foot. I don't care if you have a family. I'm sure you have a family. I'm sure you're a lovely person, but I can't deal with that right now. And I have these moments where I'm like, wow, if I had Adelina's powers. I would probably cause some serious damage. So putting a lot of that into her was very interesting. And just exploring all of the ramifications that come with a character that is unapologetic in her anger, and unapologetic in that she is not nice. She doesn't care about being nice. She is not beautiful in the traditional sense. She is marked and scarred by the fever, but she kind of wears it proudly. She has silver hair, which she's been ostracized for, but she wants people to see who she is as a person, and she wants them to fear her. She wants them to bow at her feet, and she wants power for the sake of power, and it makes her unlikable, quote, quote, which is a word that's applied to women more often than not. And I wanted her to confront that head on. So.
I think that we can all relate to an anti-hero. We all have an anti-hero inside of us, right? I certainly do. But again, it goes back to good writing. It's good writing because it's different. It's unique. You know, we don't have to paint these characters in this perfect box that they're humble and meek and all of these good things and virtuous and Captain America. Sorry.
Oh yeah! Sorry, Captain America.
Sorry,
Team Tony Stark.
Honestly, let's go to Superman for a second.
Yeah.
I mean, Superman. I'm gonna make enemies like crazy left and right. Superman is not my favorite comic hero.
I love you so much right now.
Okay. But I mean, what are his weaknesses? He's kind. That's his weakness. Like, go and tie somebody up, and he'll save him, and that's his weakness. That and some green stuff on a different planet. Are you kidding me?
It's like when you go to a job interview, and they're like, well, what's your weakest thing? You're like, I'm so efficient.
I'm just too...
I get it done.
I'm just too efficient.
I care too much. Yeah.
I care too much. I just bring too many coffees into the work every morning, and I just have to give them to people.
Like, what is your weakness? I'm Superman.
But I want to jump in there because the gender dynamic is so real with that, because it's true. Like, men get to be horrible people all throughout literature and fiction, you know, child molesters and everything else, and reviewers are like...
For our presidential candidates.
Presidential candidates, that was on my mind, yes. And everyone's like,
fantasy,
well,
fiction,
that's
reality.
Guys being guys. Right.
All a blur at this point.
And it's like, you know, what? When do women and non-men all over the world get to step up and be deliciously evil and still lovable?
And still lovable. That's the trick. That's the trick.
Yeah. And, I think there's examples throughout history for sure, but they're so few and far between. And anytime we start to breach into that territory, especially when it's a woman writer, because when men write women, it's like, oh, you guys, how did you do that? That's fantastic. You know what I mean? But when women do it, it's like, well, duh, you're a woman, whatever. You know, the reviews and the way that people treat it are so gendered, and it's so clear. I'm just really excited to read your book, basically, is what I'm trying to say. I should have done it already, but can't wait now.
People bring that kind of expectation to the characters in a book, too. Like, when you open it up and you're like, oh, here is any given kind of character. I'm just going to talk about my book again because it's coming out soon. And
February 7th?
Yeah, and it's also February just like the 7th. First example to hand. which is that there's a character who is, like, on the surface, a very flamboyant gay man who you would look at and be like, oh, yeah, a flamboyant gay man, and he performs in a cabaret. He's also a smuggler who kills people on the regular.
That's so cliche.
So he is a very flamboyant gay man, like that is who he is, but also he's ruthless, he's dangerous, he's violent, he's very smart, he's a canny businessman, and it was really important to me that both parts of his personality be like real parts of his personality, so that when you approach this character going, oh, you know, it's just, like, he's not gonna do anything important or frightening or
he's not a threat.
He's not a threat, yeah. But so I have a friend who's also an amazing writer, Sam J. Miller, who says he always loves a queer villain, even though a lot of people say, you know, why are all these Disney villains coded queer? Like, why can't we ever have a queer hero? He's like, I love a queer villain because they're strong. They're strong and they're frightening and they're a threat. So I wanted to make Aristide like both flamboyant and glamorous and also something that you wouldn't expect.
And another thing about character I think is important. Your main character was like what Marie was saying and other things you've heard, that the main character has to have a likability for you to want to go through the story with that character. But if it's good writing, that character can embody all kinds of aspects. The main thing, though, is that the reader has to be, you need to be in the shoes of that main character. You are that main character. That is your viewpoint. And you need to care about the same things that character cares about. And first person versus third person is so interesting because my book is in first person. It's very immediate because I didn't want the reader to learn things before the main character learned things. I wanted to be in his shoes. Third person is another way of having different points of view. The reader will know about certain things the main character doesn't, but at the same time, no matter how it's written, you need to be in the shoes of that main character. And I think diversity is a wonderful way to bring new ideas to readers, because if that main character, you identify with that main character, you get to be, this is what I love writing about writing, is you get to be a different person. I think that's one thing we love about reading is we can escape and become someone else. You know, I can have a wand and do cool things with that, you know, and make Patronuses and stuff, or I can, whatever it is, but I can also, you know, be in a different point of view and know a bit what that's like. And I think it opens up eyes and hopefully opens up hearts as well.
Cool. You know, I think we'll have some time to take some questions from the audience. So as you think about that, cogitate for a second, and we'll yeah, and we'll get a microphone to you. But before
microphone now.
But as we do that,
it's the coolest mic ever.
As that's coming together,
you can throw it.
No, if you throw it, we're gonna fall out of the chair.
Just chuck it at somebody.
Hello. So fun. Oh, okay.
Dodgeball.
Okay.
Are you serious?
Yep.
Okay.
Yo!
Yes.
I am so sorry, cute red-shirted girl.
Hello. So all of you have chosen to put your fantasy worlds in a setting that is not sort of what the general population will consider fantasy, which are this sort of Tolkien-esque settings. Seems like you're working a lot more contemporary fantasy genre. But in relation to that and world building, how do you feel in general about the idea of using different species as allegories for races? Is that lazy? Is that interesting? Is that a way of exploring different things? What's your general opinion about, you know, that type of paradigm and building different species into your world as well as the diversity among humans?
Closet Tolkien like fanatic. So I think it's badass. I'm sorry. I think it's great.
I'm sorry. I think it's really great.
Oh. Man, are you apologizing for ass and I've been dropping F-bombs?
I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about the cute girls in the front row.
I think they can take. They're all right.
Yeah. No, I think it's great. I think it's awesome. It just depends on what it is that you love and who you're writing for, you know, your audience. Are you writing for, because there's a huge audience that's all about different species and different things like that. And again, it's another chance to look inside
the head of somebody who's completely different than you and try and find something a relatable factor? I don't know. What do you guys think?
I think it can be. I think so often it's done wrong. And I love Tolkien too, but I think he did it wrong in the sense of if you
fight.
Fight.
I know, ready?
If I had him.
No.
If all of your orcs are bad, then that really lends itself to thinking that the different races are just that simple. Take someone like Steven Erikson, who wrote the Malazan series, which is amazing. You know, he has lots of different monsters and creatures and races, and they're all very complex within those races, right? So there's diversity within the humans, there's dark-skinned humans, light-skinned humans, men, women, lots of different characters. And then there's all the other races, they're on all different sides, so there's a really deep and rich complexity to it, and that I feel like is fantastic. But when you just have masses of orcs, you know, storming the castle, and we're supposed to be terrified of them, and there's a lot of racial coding to that, that's a big problem.
I agree with you there, but if you take the orcs aside, set the orcs aside.
Then you got dwarves.
They're like mutated, not unnatural. Then, and you look, yeah, you have dwarves and you have elves. See, you got me going. But but we're supposed to hate them for different reasons. It's complex. I love it.
I think just the key element in that question was using other species as allegories for different races. I think that is maybe the problem that Daniel was talking about, because sci-fi tends to do this too with planets, where it's like everyone from that planet is like this. Planets are huge. I don't know if you've noticed, but there's six, 7 billion
Thank
people
you.
On Earth, and they're all different from each other.
The Martians.
Yeah, so like I feel like there is an inherent issue with using other species as an allegory for a race. But I do love the idea of having different species and massive diversity within each species. It's just another element of diversity.
And I'll just say also that, that you know, Miss Piggy and Kermit are not just an interracial couple, they're an interspecies couple.
It's just another
axis. Have you thought of that?
It's another axis of
We had to think of that on Muppet Christmas Carol because they had kids, and we're like, oh God, what do we do? So... are they mutants, like pig frogs? What do they eat? And so we just kept it the girls are pigs and the boys are frogs. But it's like
gender essentialist.
It was a Christmas story. But that wasn't my choice. You should have seen the designs I had. Anyway, but it's around us everywhere. It's around us everywhere. And I think, yes, you absolutely can and should do that.
Just so it's not our panelists saying controversial things about beloved fictional characters like Tolkien. Say Kermit the Frog is my hero and he could do so much better than Miss Piggy.
Oh, no, you didn't. Oh, no, you didn't.
Wow.
The gauntlet has...
So I think think our cube has floated around. Do you have a question? Speaking to the cube.
So as someone who is really, really white, trying to write a world that is very diverse, knowing that I come from this legacy of white supremacy and all these terrible things, I'm terrified of messing it up. And I'm trying to do the best I can to make it realistic and real. And I'm currently going with the world of color thing because I'm tired of seeing white people everywhere. But I was wondering if any of you had any advice on how to not mess it up.
Write fantasy. No, really, that's the biggest thing. Because I relate to that. I relate to that. I think that's why, you know, if it can make it fictitious and show kind of an allegory for society versus trying to be literal, that's my secret. Anybody else?
You know, I think that's a really great question to ask and very timely. I think my number one piece of advice, because the thing is, we all are going to mess up at some point. I have messed up in my own writing before. I will probably do it again. I don't want to, but the number one thing you have to remember is never defend yourself. When you get called out for something, never defend yourself. When asking for advice from others on making sure that your writing is tackling something correctly, and they tell you an answer that may not necessarily be what you want to hear or like to hear, listen. to it. I think that is absolutely the most important thing that someone can do, is to not defend themselves and to listen.
Yeah, I actually wrote a piece about this on BuzzFeed called 12 Fundamentals of Writing the Other and the Self, which is better than anything I could say right now.
Required reading, actually.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that. And definitely what y'all said, and especially the listening thing. Listening is not a skill that we're taught as writers, but it needs to be, particularly when we're talking about writing folks who aren't us. And I think you're off to a really great start by the way you framed the question at owning who you are, because I think that's where a lot of writers go wrong, is trying to pretend that they don't exist somehow, or that their, you know, many biases and their relationship to power doesn't matter when they come to the page. And it absolutely does. You know, it'd be very disingenuous for me as a man, or me as a Latino who's not black, writing a character who is neither those things or one of those things or whatever, to pretend that me being who I am doesn't affect how I'm gonna put that character on the page and how I'm gonna put other characters who may represent me on the page, right? Because often the biggest mistake is writing ourselves. We're terrible at it because we try to protect ourselves. So men write men, you know, cis men writing cis men who just know all the answers and save the world all the time, which is in fact very often the opposite of what's true. And like, we need to really just be able to own our shit and listen. And you know, as much as research is huge, like yes, do your research, but that's really step one. Like the factual stuff, you can know all the factual stuff in the world and still jack it up monumentally. And there's a long history of folks doing that. It's called anthropology. So what you need to do is understand power as best as you can. And it's tough because it's a soul question. It's not just an academic question, but those are the ones that are really hard to get at. But I really feel like you're on a great track in just how you're thinking it through and asking the question.
Who's got the cue?
I have it.
Okay, and then, in front of you.
I'm a middle school librarian in Brooklyn, and I'm constantly
on
the lookout.
Yeah, you're a superhero. Yay. You are Thank a superhero. You.
Yay, middle school. Yay, Brooklyn. Yay, librarian.
We appreciate you.
Yeah,
that's
thanks.
The trifecta.
And I'm constantly on the lookout for diverse books where the main storyline isn't oppression or bigotry, because I see my young readers really need that. And I was wondering if you have experiences as young readers that you go back to when you saw yourself in print, or anything that you want to share with us.
What was the last part I didn't
understand? If you have formative experiences as young readers seeing yourself in print, and what was that like?
Tamara Pierce.
Oh.
Yeah. That's my only answer to that question, is if you don't know who Tamara Pierce is, I'm sorry. You need to find out immediately, especially if there are young women in your life, especially if there are young queer people in your life. I thought you were holding that up and just being like, 10 out of 10. No.
I was trying to be subtle.
Tamara Pierce was like, I never thought that there was anything that I couldn't do, because I had seen young women in her books do everything. Yeah.
It's very different now, because when I was growing up and looking at books, there were, because I'm also Jewish, and so I was trying to find Jewish characters, gay characters, you know, whatever. And it was really, really hard. And also the role models were hard in all of culture. But I think that's why when I said we have a responsibility as authors, it's true, because we want, another hat I wear is I'm art director at Simon & Schuster Children's Books, and I design many middle grade YA novels. And so
is there anything you don't do?
I don't fix cars. I know nothing about cars, which is not a bad thing. So I read a lot of YA, and I read a lot of middle grade books, and the books that are up and coming, and what everyone's looking. But you know, we will publish books that are, you know, that are very commercial, mainstream kind of books, but it does afford us to, if those sell really well, it does afford us to publish the books that need to be published that may sell a couple hundred copies, but they have to get out there. And so it is a goal. I think everybody, especially now, everybody is, and librarians are the superheroes. I'm sincere, because forefront of this, of getting books in the hands of kids who need to see themselves, and it's a different world now. So for me personally, it wasn't there, but it is. I think it's much more there now. Thank God.
I just want to say I'm happy we have an ambassador from Sesame Street here, because my first time culturally recognizing something in mass media was Sonia Manzano playing Maria, that she is my mom. Like, she really is. And I got to interview her last year, and it was really hard for me not to just be like, you're my mom.
Yeah, don't
but
tell her that.
But it was a struggle, you know, because we were on camera. And she's just so incredible. And I consider Sesame Street a really amazing kind of form of urban fantasy, you know, because there are just these folks living with these little monsters, you know, and relating to them in a very real way, in a very human way, and just interacting in a daily basis. And there's almost like a magical realism quality to it. So, you know, as a kid, as a Latino kid growing up in Boston, in a very white part of Boston, in a house that was steeped in magical realism with a very Cuban mom, seeing like this woman who looked like my mom and acted and had an accent like my mom talking to little monsters was the realest thing that I could possibly imagine. So, you know, that's such a gift. And I think to feel that gift, you know, as a young kid and then later as a young writer and then now as an old ass writer, I feel like, you know, that's so much of an engine to what I do. So it's so amazing that, you know, you're a part of that.
Hi, I'm Shamika Mitchell. I'm assistant professor of English at State University of New York, Rockland campus. And I have to get all of you to come to my campus at some point. So, but I wanted to ask about the concept of dystopia, which is such a trend, I guess, as a reflection of real life. What would your utopia look like? And how would you write it? Yeah, I got questions. Because dystopia is the thing that people are, you know, gravitating towards, what would your utopia look like and how would you write it?
Utopia.
Utopia, yeah.
That's a good question.
Thank you.
Somebody else answer.
I can't. No writer has ever thought of this.
Yeah, I know.
They were like,
I never had to think about that.
No conflict. It was, there's no story.
Thing. I mean, you were talking about rainbows and fluffy things, right?
Right.
I'm working on a project right now that is actually has a civilization that is focused on trying to find a utopia. And it is a very, it looks communist to anybody who's read it, and I'm like, I'm not a communist. But at the same time, it's just about, I mean, can't we all just get along? You know, people that come to this place because it's a refugee from all of the other terrible provinces that are out there, and they come and they have to do their share and they work, but they're respected and they're valued as citizens and things like that. So I guess that's my utopia. I don't know.
I think there's a reason why dystopia is a thing in literature and utopia really isn't, is because, you know, literature and fiction is really based on conflict, right? And utopia, it's like, where are you going to find that conflict? Boring ass
boring
books. So there's that. And that's why we're all sitting here like, that's not something we think about. That's but I will say that during the Black Lives Matter protests, which are ongoing, we were taking over bridges and laying down in the streets, you know, for justice and continue to. And those moments, it was particularly stark to me when I would leave the march and get on the train and be back in the world of people that don't really give a shit about any of that stuff going on. And it was a very stark, it was kind of like getting out of a hot shower into a cold room. And that felt like in the midst of all this conflict and there's cops all around and people getting arrested and immense violence in the air, there was a sense of, this is the first time in my life that I've been present for a multiracial movement to end racism, and that felt like the closest thing I've ever known to a utopia.
I think I think we've got time for one more question where my cube has gotten to. Okay. No pressure.
Yeah, this is the first time I've ever asked a question at a panel before.
Yay!
Hi. So I was really excited to come to this panel, partly because it was talking about class and social structure, and I know you guys sort of touched on that briefly, but I feel like in a lot of fantasy, and even in a lot of non-fantasy fiction, that's sort of glossed over, and so I was hoping you guys could talk about that a little bit.
They're itching to go.
Okay. I actually wrote something down here to talk about class, and then we hardly ever talked about it at all. So there are three main characters in my book. One of them is old money, like that has never been an issue for him. But the other two main characters are both, so like I wrote my note down here says talk about them as people who, the myth of pulling yourself up by your bootstraps, that both of them come from very impoverished backgrounds, and one of them has sort of managed this and is now like wealthy, semi-respected, mostly feared, and the other one is a woman who has failed, who is also from an impoverished background, who has tried to, like, she's surviving, but there's no idea that, like, through striving and striving and striving, that she's going to make it out of this ironclad class structure that she's kind of trapped in. And it was really important to me that the class differences of the three characters who interact throughout this book are not glossed over, that there is conflict, because when the old money character, for instance, who is a man from a wealthy family whose parents were important and politically influential, interacts with this woman whose mother died when she was very young, who's dealing drugs to pay her rent, which she sometimes misses anyway if she doesn't make good tips at her job stripping in a burlesque club, that they just can't, there are some things that they can't see eye to eye. And it doesn't stop them from interacting. It doesn't stop them from working together, but it is a constant source of tension in their relationship.
I think that the Robin Hood themes of Brandon Sanderson does this really well in his Mistborn series, where he the concept of the impoverished, the thieves that are trying to bring down the upper crust. I think he does a great job of that, and then. But that Robin Hood trope is common throughout fiction, I think, and we tend to, as commoners, tend to be drawn to that because we like the idea of, you know, actually mattering in this world that is being run. Let's not go there. Never mind.
Well, I'm so glad that you brought up the issue of class, because it's true that we haven't covered it nearly enough, but. It's so timely because I feel like our country is in this spot of the haves and have-nots in a way that I don't think we've had in a long, long, long time, if ever. My first series, Legend, was all about class. It's told in two alternating points of view from a girl from the have society. She's extremely wealthy, meeting a boy from the other side of the tracks, and all of the extremities, like what comes with the extremity of that when there's no middle class. In a society. Like, I live in LA, and I don't think there's a place I've been to in the States where you can see that so drastically. Like, you can literally be shopping at Louis Vuitton on one street, and you step one block over, and it's you see the tents and Skid Row and people in the streets. And that's why that whole series was set in LA, because it's just a real-life dystopia that you can see with your own eyes. And, you know, it's, like, I'm an immigrant kid. Like, when we came over to the States, I remember spending, like, the summers in a broom closet in this, like, restaurant that my mom was working at because she didn't have anywhere else to keep me at the time. And, like, I mean, they had, like, a TV and a couch in there. So it was not, it was a very nice broom closet. But, you know, you don't forget that. And I think a lot of people get forgotten that way, and it's interesting to tackle that stuff in fiction because, you know, we see it all the time in real life, and we have to reflect that in fiction as well.
Sure. Well, for good or ill, we've gotten the high sign. We've only scratched the surface, but if you want to continue the conversation, and you know you do, you should head up to the sixth floor where you'll be doing a signing, imminently. I want to thank all y'all for coming. I want to thank our panel, Laurent, Lara, Jennifer, Daniel, Marie.